Now, before we get into the interior of this 911 992 generation Turbo S, I want to talk about something we normally don't address on this channel, and that is exterior styling. Take a gander at this thing. If you're coming from the prior generation 991.2 911 Turbo, you'll notice that this thing is wider. It is 40 millimeters wider in the front and 10 millimeters wider in the rear. This is, in fact, the body, or at least the body shell, that they use on the cup cars. They styled the 992 generation 911 to harken back to Porsches of yesteryear, specifically the 930 Turbo, which is the air-cooled Porsche from the late 70s, early 80s, the turbocharged variant. You have ginormous carbon ceramic brakes. They are 10 piston and standard on the Turbo S. A lot of the styling in this car is relatively subtle, but I think compared to a regular 911, it's got a huge street presence. So let's talk about the cabin. Inside the 911 Turbo S, now if you're coming from a regular 911 video or 992 generation, a lot of this is going to be a carryover. So what is this car? This is the most expensive, one of the fastest variants of the 911 currently on option. And as tested, it is $225,000, which makes it a very expensive proposition. But when it comes to the attention to detail and overall build quality of this cabin, it feels every bit of its price. I know this is a cliche, but it feels like a bank vault in here. Nothing rattles, nothing squeaks. Everything feels very expensive. And I cannot say that about some of its more exotic rivals like Aston Martin or Ferrari. Now, the ergonomics of this car at its core is standard 992, which means you have great visibility, all the inputs are great, the pedal box is superb, and all of the controls that need to be physical are physical. The comfort level of this cabin is, again, what you're expecting at this price point. You have a couple different seat options, but this 18-way adjustable seat, I believe, is standard, and they are tremendously comfortable. They fit a wide variety of body types, and when you are on the track, they also hold you in fairly well. Plus, the heated and cooled function is a nice plus, and the cooled seats really do a good job. This also has the optional glass roof, which makes this cabin feel a little bit more airy. And if you are going to use this as a GT, like this car is intended to be, it really adds to the ambiance of this cabin. When it comes to electronics, this is standard 911. However, I am very thankful that we have the Burmester premium audio system. This is the optional advanced audio system, most expensive one you can put in this car. It tests very well for a cramped coupe, though I do believe the audio system in the LC500 is far superior. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is the cargo space in this car. This is a compromised, dedicated sports car, so this is probably not going to be the most practical vehicle you've ever been in, but the frunk is large enough for some soft bags, and the rear seats are a huge plus. While they are not large enough for full adults, unless you don't like your friends, they are useful for the school run if you have smaller children, or you can use it as a storage area. So with all of that out of the way, let's head to the shop and put this thing on the lift so we can talk about the massive amount of engineering that goes into this car.
Jack, we're under the 992 911 Turbo S. There is so much to cover here. I'm not even going to say anything other than we did do a Carrera 992, which is somewhat of a different body, but most of the technology carries over, and then this just gets amped up to a 10.
Yes. So if you want to learn everything there is to learn about what they've changed for this generation 911, I highly suggest you watch that video. Here are the highlights, though. The 992 generation is an all-new body structure from the prior generation. It is lighter, more torsionally rigid due to the increase in high-strength steel and a further use of aluminum. So it's on a modular architecture called MMB, which the 718 is also on, despite the different engine placement. However, this is a Turbo S. This is the currently, at least currently, this is the fastest 911 you can buy in a straight line. It is not a track car. It's not a GT car. GT is the denomination for track-focused Porsche products that are developed by a different team. This is still a street car. Their goal for this was to make an everyday supercar. I know that's the biggest cliche in the world.
Right, everybody says it now.
But this is really an everyday supercar. It does 0 to 60 in the low twos. They claim 2.5. Car and Driver Motor Trend got it to 2.2 or 2.1.
The point is you can get almost those numbers every single time doing a normal person launch.
Yes, and that is almost... No, I can't think of another car that can do that other than, you know, like a Tesla. But as an ICE or an internal combustion powered vehicle, this is mind-blowing.
And if you look at it, it definitely, for me, when I look at a 911, the joke is I can never tell them apart generationally. but the turbo does have a much different stance, and we kind of showed you some of the exterior footage of it, but it has a real street presence to it.
It is a very wide car that does get a surprising amount of attention for a 911. So Mark, let's get into the back and talk about the suspension and all the other fun bits, including the engine and drivetrain.
Okay.
So we've made it to the rear of the 992 911 Turbo S. Before I talk about the suspension, I want to quickly talk about the active aerodynamics. So the front of this vehicle, you have an active front diffuser or lower chin spoiler. It will change all variety of degrees and angles to aid you at higher speeds. This car has a max terminal velocity of 205 miles an hour.
Oh, you mean you need active aero for a 205 mile an hour car?
I know, that's really surprising. And you also have front active vents for cooling and again, aerodynamics. And in the rear, you have a giant rear wing. And this thing has almost 400 pounds of downforce when this is in the most aggressive mode, which is Sport Plus. And much like in the regular 911, all of the various drive modes change every aspect of this vehicle, from the way the rear steer works, the way the wing works, the way the front wing works, everything. This is a very, very complicated car. That's where your money's going. And the rear wing also acts as a giant air brake, which you're probably gonna need at 205 miles an hour. And that number is no joke. You will hit 100 miles an hour in about 5.7 seconds in this vehicle. And at the quarter, at 10.5 seconds, I think you're in like the high 130s.
You could probably get this thing under 10 seconds if they cut off some of the aero. You know, like you have to have that balance.
Yes.
And I think, you know, this car would be way faster if they didn't employ or deploy all these different aero effects to keep the car balanced, because that's part of the design of this car is comfort, balance, aerodynamics, grip. I mean, they've tried to do everything here, and
they, for the most part, as we're going to talk about,
for $200,000, it works real well.
It works great. At about 100 miles an hour, Mark, it feels like you could literally get out and walk. It's that stable.
Yeah.
Something to talk about next is the suspension architecture. Much like you've seen in the Carrera S, you have front and rear aluminum subframes. The front suspension is strut versus the double wishbone, which is available in the 992 GT3, which you will see a video on real soon. Mark is going to probably age 500 years trying to edit this long-form documentary, so please be excited. But tell me the differences, because we're going to talk about it in the track, but tell me the differences between a strut suspension and a double wishbone in a car like this, and how you have to drive Porsches a little differently with strut suspension.
Well, you have rear engine.
Yes.
And having that weight transfer to the front on a strut that is has to be load-bearing. I think that's the main thing people don't understand with a strut. It has to do two things at once. As you transfer the weight, technically, in a car like this, you should be able to load up those front wheels and have a ton of grip. But as you turn, oftentimes, if you get your braking done too late, that front end starts to get a little bit vague and will tend to wash out. So you have to drive it differently than a traditional like mid-engine car or a front-engine car. So this is way more noticeable now that we've been out of the new GT3. We've driven the GT3 on track with the changeover to double wishbone suspension, and that's where you really see it. And I think if you get a chance to drive these two cars generationally, or even the 992 911 back to back with the GT3, just to feel the front end, it is night and day difference in terms of grip stability. So one of the things that you notice with this car is it tends to feel like it's moving around a little bit in the front end. It's a little bit less planted. It just feels overall to the average person, it feels like it has less grip. But they've developed the strut suspension on this car over countless years. And if you had to say what manufacturer does the best job in terms of suspension design, it would be these guys, because this is nothing short of a miracle how well it performs. And you said it right off the bat, this is not a track car, but the fact that you can go out on a track with this car, and I'm not kidding you, this thing just made this made race cars disappear, and obviously you're not going to be driving this in a race, but it is so fast, so capable, so confidence inspiring, and it's all these systems working together. The back, rear wheel steering, these sub-motor assemblies that are in each corner, just tow in that rear just a little bit to give you that stability to help you turn in, but at no point does it ever feel like this car is going to walk away from you.
You talked to Andy Pilgrim about, I guess it's hard for a regular person to understand where the car is doing it in physical grip,
right,
versus aerodynamics versus stability control. Do you think that's a fair statement for this car too?
Yeah, it is the same. And I got out of the GT3, and one of the things I thought of in my head is, like, I'm trying to figure out mentally how all of these things are working together and what it's actually doing and what I'm feeling. And it's this confusing point when you're kind of like us, we're adept drivers, but we're not a race car driver. We're not competing at a high level.
Yeah, we didn't race at Le Mans.
Right,
yeah.
Right. So you kind of lose... You lose the vision of what the car is really doing when you're really at that edge of the limit, when you start to add in past mechanical grip and you're putting in the aero advantages of a car like this. And the thing for me is, I'm not quite sure as a regular driver, where am I getting aero stability versus mechanical grip, and where one ends and the other one begins, and where you can trust the car and lean on it. And I would say the better the car, the easier it is to feel that advantage of the aero. And this is one of those cars, when you're at 80, 90, 120 miles an hour, you feel the car being sucked down. You don't feel the rear end moving around like cars that don't have aero that tend to lift the rear up. This car, you feel actually hunkering down. And in these longer speed sections or sweepers, you're turning, you're like, is the back's gonna walk? The back's gotta go, and it never goes. and you can build speed up, and that's what's amazing about a car like this, and what you're paying a lot of the money for in motorsports engineering, or engineering their know-how here. This has just been, again, it's been evolved to almost perfection, and that's why people love 911s.
The last thing I'm gonna talk about, which is also a contentious point for the both of us, is the optional, for the first time ever, PASM Sport suspension. So it's an option. It lowers the suspension by 10 millimeters, and it is a stiffer suspension setup than the regular Turbo S in the 992. It is, and they didn't give me rates to compare it to the regular suspension on this car, but compared to the prior generation PASM cars, it is up to 40% stiffer than the prior generation car. So again, they're trying to turn this vehicle into a fully dual-purpose car, where I think it's best suited more as a GT, which, again, I'm sure if you took to a regular track, you would annihilate everything there anyway,
yeah,
even with the softer suspension.
I mean, it's nice that it's an option, but truthfully, I think it would be better without it. You
yes.
have a dedicated sports car with the harder suspension, and you turn this into, like, that rocket ship that has a good ride, and this sacrifices some of it. I mean, it's not horrible.
No, it's not.
But out here, it's definitely noticeable, and it detracts, or it's distracting more. It's a more busy, more rough ride over certain pavement types. We'll let you decide whether you want to spend the extra money for it.
Perfect. So let's talk about the engine, Mark.
Go for it.
So the engine is from the same engine family as the regular 911. And in fact, the Boxer as well. This is a modular platform, like you're kind of expecting. This is not like a true motorsports engine, like the 4-liter found in the GT3s. The way it gets 640 horsepower and like 580 or 590 foot-pounds of torque is it has bigger turbos, a different direct injection system with larger injectors, new charge cooling systems, more cooling, and that's something I'm gonna talk about here as well, because there are an astronomical number of coolers on this car. And it produces even more boost than it did before as well. So that's how all of this thrust happens, is through this 3.75 liter engine, or flat six. It also has made it to an 8-speed PDK, which is similar to what you find in a regular 911. However,
it's been strengthened, and I'm not sure if they did
the ratios are changed.
The ratios are changed. So it's the same transmission family, but it has been improved because of the heat, because of the power that is going through
here. And the added torque.
The all-wheel drive system is, this is a rear-wheel drive car.
Yep.
And it is essentially 90-10 all the time. Mm-hmm. It's always sending power to the rear wheels, and it will transfer like half the amount of torque to the front when needed to kind of pull you through. But most of the time, this thing feels rear-wheel driven. And the front wheel drive system, or the front drive system, is the magic behind launching this thing and putting your brain into a scrambled mode or wanting to puke. So all of this stuff is here to help you go faster and drive faster, more effortlessly.
It feels like a very organic all-wheel drive system. It's there always to add traction to the vehicle, but it doesn't feel like it's just saving you all the time. It's like in the background. We talked about this. All the various systems, much like in the regular 911, you have PDCC, which is the active sway bars front and rear, PASM, which is their active dampers, all the stability control modes, which again are tied into all the different drive modes, and the rear steer, plus the aerodynamics, are all working together at the same time to make you feel like a driving god without entirely eliminating the driver. Last thing to talk about is cooling, and along with this all-wheel drive system, which unlike something like a GTR, according to Porsche, you can just keep using it and using it, launch after launch after launch, and it will not blow up. I'm sure if it does, you'll be bankrupt once the warranty's out.
Right,
but
yeah.
The amount of abuse this PDK can take is magic.
Yeah. And you're never worried about it when you're driving it, honestly. And I think the only thing that I did notice when we were driving it on track to kind of like feel the car out is you can tell the electronic systems manage the power quite well. Yeah. As you're going and going and the heat rises, it was hot out. You could feel the power, maybe like a 5% difference, but it's not significant where you're like, oh, this thing's a dog. There's going to be heat soak on any turbo car, but I think they're really doing a good job managing it where you don't feel like the whole fun is being zapped out of it, but it's safe, reliable, at least in this package. Yes. And while it's under warranty, I would just drive the hell out of it.
Yes. So cooling quickly, the oiling system on this thing is a dry sump and it's integrated into the car itself. It's not a wet sump system, which allows it to pull more G-forces without it oil starving. And you have an astronomical number of coolers. You have three in the front. You have intercoolers, you have a dedicated oil cooler, and you have a dedicated trans and diff cooler for this car, which means in our short track session, and we were going relatively hard, this thing in 90 plus degree weather didn't move above like 250.
No, I mean, literally, it was a car that you didn't have to worry about. You sit there with the air conditioning running in it, idling like...
with your cooled seats on.
My cooled seats on. I mean, that's what this is. That's what it's capable of. And I understand why people spend so much money on it, Jack.
Yeah, so with that, Mark, let's hit the road.
All right.
So Mark, we're in the 992 911 Turbo S and we're in our cliche farm road about to demonstrate some German excellence to you.
Oh no.
So we're in Sport Plus, PASM Sport, and hopefully launch control activates like it's supposed to. Oh! Oh my god.
Oh my god, dude, that's enough. Oh my god, dude, this is not gonna work on the street. There's no way we're doing anything on the road, regular road, with this car.
So with that, Mark, I think it's time for us to head to Autobahn Country Club so I don't go to jail.
Let's try this again, Jack.
Yeah, we're at our home away from home, Autobahn Country Club here in Joliet.
Yeah, let's try this thing.
Without legal trouble.
Yes. Wow. Holy shit, dude. This is on another planet of speed. One of the things I wanted to talk about before we get too crazy with how it feels and what it's like is in the modern world, there are a lot of fast cars.
Yes.
There are fast cars that also don't feel rewarding. And I think we're caught up in this now. Like the CA Corvette at launch is one of those where it's really fast in a straight line. It has all the great numbers, but it's not rewarding to drive fast. The Tesla Model S, the performance lines, and now the new ones that are coming out, they're even faster. They may have these explosive numbers. They're going to pass supercars, but it's not a car in its stock form that is makes you feel a whole lot. The Turbo S is a really good balance between making you feel something and being insanely fast in every single condition. And how this car separates itself from a lot of the competition is this is purpose-built. It has some of the biggest or most development of any sports car in history, and it has racing pedigree, like real racing pedigree, not just marketing bullshit that we talk about a lot.
It sounds like I've converted you to the Church of 9/11, Mark. Welcome, brother.
But there is one problem with this,
okay,
Jack.
Yeah, what is it?
Okay.
I'm not hearing a lot of problems so far.
When we did the GT3 launch, We got behind this car.
Yes.
In a straight line. This car was faster than the GT3.
We launched first in the GT3. Patrick Long was in a 911 Turbo S identical to this, and we just watched him disappear into the sunset.
Yes. I will take the GT3 over this 10 out of 10 times. As a driver, that car is rewarding to drive fast much more than this. And the big factor is it has this musicality to it. It has this resonance, this vibration, and it has this connectedness that this car kind of removes a bit, because
it's meant to be a car that can do everything. And I say that all the time, but unlike the GT3, which has a purpose-built mission to be a motorsports car, this, and this is the biggest cliche in the world, is supposed to be an everyday supercar. But I will say this, it accomplishes that task. I have never driven a car that can go as fast as this can down the highway, be totally comfortable, be driven year-round, because this has one of the most impressive all-wheel drive systems I've ever experienced. German space magic levels of gearbox technology and a motor that is just... While it lacks that really high-pitched wail of the GT3, at least up to 7,000 RPM, it sounds very similar to the other Carrera S motors. But one disappointment, and I get why they have to do this, it doesn't rev.
Well, when you have all this horsepower and you can literally put your eyeballs into your brains, I understand. You can't make this, in terms of a street car, wind out like a race car and then have all that torque.
And still be reliable.
Right. So let's talk about, just really quickly, street manners before I really start to drive this in a track condition. The rear wheel steering, all the mechanical, electromechanical systems here that we talked about in the shop make this one of the best sports cars that you could daily drive, aside from the things that we talked about in the interior space. Now, I think the best thing to do is really give people a true explanation of what this car is like and how fast it builds speed in track settings, and we'll talk about the mechanical part.
All right.
We're on the track, Jack. Look at those numbers climb.
Oh my God, dude.
I think what's crazy to me is, like I said, fast is different than fast and rewarding. And you would never know it in this car. They find such a balance. You know, if it had that more wailing engine sound, I think it would. I would change my opinion on it. What do you think?
I think that the way this thing gets around this track without drama, but without feeling like it's totally doing everything for you, like in the C8, this is, it's pretty hard to argue with the fact that you can really get this thing to Jekyll and Hyde. I'm going to be honest, you and I have driven a lot of cars around south at Autobahn, and this is probably the fastest thing we've ever been around here.
Yeah, it's pretty quick. I mean, the GT500 was also quick, but this is on another planet. It really is. So I'll talk through some of the mechanical stuff I've noticed, and since we just got out of the new GT3, it's pretty apparent the front end is way different on this car. It feels softer to me, way softer than the GT3, far less planted. It's got that old kind of like the front end's trying to do a little bit too much. I mean, it feels stable.
Because it's still strut versus the double wishbone that the 992 GT3 has.
It just doesn't feel as like planted. I guess that's the best way to put it.
How does the steering in this compare to the GT3?
Well, I feel like it's more relaxed. It doesn't load up as much as the GT3. So when you turn, you feel, you kind of feel the front end washing out a little bit. If you don't get your braking done right, it kind of loads up later. So you have to get your braking done a little bit faster.
Yeah.
Like more in a straight line than the GT3. But once you get it lined up and then you're working with the car and you want to get out of a corner, man, does this thing pull out of a corner.
Yeah, the traction levels in this car are just astronomical. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, you have active aero. You have the active aero, you have rear wheel steering, you have all the electronic systems working with you, you have all wheel drive.
PDCC as well, the active sway bars. This is a...
absolutely incredible, it really is. I'm just astounded at how far cars have come, and this is proof in terms of chassis. Like suspension, chassis, aero, this has everything going for it. This isn't really, I know it's a dual purpose car. This is supposed to be streetable, and it's stream a little, you can go out here and you're just like, you're like, God.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's crazy.
If you are thinking about possibly buying one of these, and you have the funds to spend the $225,000 required of you, just do it. I mean, this is I have no complaints, man.
Yeah, I think it's pretty amazing, man. I think we've covered almost every single thing that we could talk about with this car and then some.
So, Mark, I don't think there's a whole lot else for us to cover. So with that, Mark, let's get into the final thoughts.
Sounds good, Jack. Let's do it.
All right, cool it down. Final thoughts on the 911 Turbo S. If you are someone who loves engineering or just values a tremendous driving car, you will be absolutely floored by this thing. Its ability to do nearly everything perfectly is almost frustrating. You want a daily driver? Not a problem. This is a car that sits in traffic without issue and very comfortably. You want to use it as a GT cruiser or a long distance missile? The 911's got you covered. And lastly, this is a car that you can absolutely dominate a racetrack with or tear up your favorite back road with no problems. Unlike some of its more exotic competitors, this is a car that you can actually use every single day. Unless your name is Nick Murray, 911s have historically been very reliable. They have high residuals, and the dealer network, at least compared to Aston Martin and Ferrari, has historically been very, very good. Now, what are its negatives? The first is, I can't afford it. At $225,000, this is a lot of money, and with how good the regular Carrera S is, it's hard to make that value proposition. Next, if your name is John Flex and you want your money, again, you just spent $225,000 to be very loud and announce to the world that you're rich, the Turbo S may not be for you. It's not a very shouty car. And now lastly, this is also not the most emotional vehicle in its price segment or its class. It doesn't have the roar of a V8 or its high revving nature. It's also not the scariest or emotional driving experience. It's not a car that always wants to get upset under the power. It's not like you're wrestling a bear or a crocodile. This is a far more subdued experience. The emotional highs come from its sheer proficiency. So with that said, thank you for watching and going on this very special journey with us.